extremely pleased tonight to have as our speaker someone who grew up in Richmond, Virginia, and I think still has the spirit of Gabriel Prosser, the genius whose statue should be taller than any other in Richmond. Our speaker glories in her history and culture, and would be someone that Prosser would honor if he were alive. I believe that. Dr. Christel Temple attended Varina High School, the College of William and Mary, the University of Maryland at Baltimore County, and got her PhD in African American Studies from Temple. Already a giant in the field because of her serious analysis of scholarship, Dr. Christel Temple has published several important books, including Literary Pan-Africanism, History, Context, and Criticism in 2005, and Literary Spaces in 2007. In addition, she has maintained a high profile as a writer of articles and essays. Her numerous awards include being the recipient of the Sheikh Anta Diop International Conference Award for Best Scholarly Book and the Aya Founders Award for Scholarly Innovation. We are fortunate to have her in the house tonight. She is currently Associate Professor in the Department of Africana Studies at the University of Pittsburgh. She is a fellow to this institute, and she serves on the editorial board of the Journal of Black Studies and is on the Executive Council for DISA, which is the Diopian Institute for Scholarly Advancement, and sits as a member of the Executive Committee for Black Religion and Spirituality Conference at the Michigan State University. Known for her wide-ranging references that reflect a thorough education and her Afrocentric lens on literary and culture phenomena, Dr. Temple is a marvel of intellect, wisdom, and joy, and is the mother of Tyler, a beautiful son. Here is Dr. Christel Temple. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I get hot. I get worked up. I get excited as I present, so I know I'm going to sweat, so let's take care of that right away. It is truly an honor to be here. That's the most honoring introduction I've ever had. And I just want to make the ancestors proud. And I just want to do something that makes life for the future generations richer and in a morsel sort of way, finding these morsels of our culture and celebrating ourselves and advancing ourselves. I'd like to thank Dr. Asante for inviting me here. I'd like to thank Anna and Stephanie for getting me here after the invitation. And I thank all of you for coming out tonight. I pay honor to Dr. Amma Mazama. I'm one of those write a 20-page paper and deliver it type of people. And I stopped reading and delivering and used some of my performance theatrics, and it's been successful, but I want to be here, and I want to talk, and I want to think, and I want to slow it down and not squeeze a paper into 20 minutes like we've been doing at our conferences. So what I've given you is a definition, my favorite go-to definition of folklore from Tolagbe Ogunleye, African-American folklore, its role in reconstructing African-American history, because, and I'm not going to read it, you have it. But we need this definition because I think folklore gets lost. And later in this article, Ogunleye, he takes issue with the way folklore has been defined as kind of the least common denominator of what Black people do, what's funny and humorous, not necessarily what's clever. And so, for example, if you've seen the movie I'm Gonna Get You, Sucker, and I know no one wants to raise your hand sitting at the MOLEFI KETE Asante Institute saying, I've seen I'm Gonna Get You, Sucker. But for example, there's a scene where the woman, Anne-Marie somebody, light-skinned Johnson, she dates this man and he gets her home and she takes off her wig and she has fake apparatus here and fake in the back and takes off her hip and has one leg and all of that stuff. I saw that and I chuckled, hee hee, ha ha, interesting. And then when I read Daryl Cumber Dance's collection on African-American folklore, I found out that that's an old school joke. It's a joke. And so even Dance's presentation of folklore and many others, they're really looking at dozens and jokes and not the cultural honorable things that are going to take our generations into the next and next and next generation. And so this is a powerful definition of folklore. And I wrote my paper before I went to the archive and retrieved this definition that I knew I was going to give out. And lo and behold, one of the key concepts of my presentation is in the second line. So if you could just underline or pay attention to the word cognitions. Cognitions. Okay. So this evening I'm talking about new interpretations of our folklore, literature, and creative production. Who are we culturally? And it also could have another brief title called Literary Afrocentricity, because that's basically what we do, and these things are meshed. And so after I set my paper down, I set out in the car today, wandering around, just thinking of collecting my thoughts, my generic thoughts on what I want to convey today. And I have several anecdotes, many anecdotes I want to share today. But have you ever heard anyone say, he'd rather play outside than read? Or say, she'd rather play outside than read. And that's usually said after, you know, they've just metaphorically put the dunce cap on someone. A bad grade, a low test score, an allegedly non-intellectual aptitude. So if I were outside, what would I be doing? I'd be communing with nature, picking some berries off the tree like we used to do in the country in Virginia, having fights. Well, we knew which ones weren't going to burst. We knew which ones the snakes didn't eat. So I'd be learning about my environment. I'd be playing that game, here we go, Zootio, 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 here we go, which I happen to see on Daughters of the Dust and other things. And so that there are chants and some things, and we may have lost pieces of it, but I just don't see that playing outside or reading are either or choices where you're sacrificing your education. I understand what some people mean by it, but that's one thought I've had. I understand that our children need to read to increase their vocabulary, right? At a young age, to be familiar with things. But did our ancestors take the SAT? African traditional and ancestors cultivating oratory and listening and hearing and all those things. Did they take the SAT? I got a chuckle, so you understand where I'm going. Did they have a summer reading list? These books, I got to sit down and stop playing and read. Were they less intelligent? Absolutely, absolutely not. And so when we think of who we are culturally, books, reading, and all of that stuff, there is a stylized traditional African education, and then there is the modern academic education. I even want to call it the contemporary academic education, because now we're teaching toward tests. And I don't even understand that, because if we're teaching toward a test, how do I get to be invited into a classroom, K through 12, to take up some time to teach students how to think differently beyond just reading comprehension, what's the main point of this story, and talk about some of the African-centered elements that would bloom if we just took more time focusing on that one line, like a study of one of our sacred texts. So what exactly did we learn in traditional African education? There's an author, I don't remember his first name, last name is Abing, and he's in African Culture, Rhythms of Unity, and he has a chapter called Traditional African Culture, and he talks about African culture. Traditional African culture is storytelling, it's the use of proverbs, and we know how proverbs can really elevate your consciousness as children. You hear them, you hear your parents say it, and then you get to the stage of the level of imitation and duplication and reproduction, because your experience with life shows you, it reveals what these brief morsels and sayings meant. Riddles, age groups, rites of passage, age groups, what you learn within your own within your own sex, women together, men together, because we do have some differences that we need to understand before we come together and celebrate and then write about love. So think of a novel on love versus what you learn in those groups, but it's related, but we learn all these things in traditional African education. We learn our place in the world. We learn communication styles. We learned about the land and our environment in which we live. We learned about our heritage, history, and ancestors. We learn about ethics, wisdom, justice. We learn about crafts and trade, spirituality, myths. How about we learn about security and what to do when some outsider is coming? And this is through the most elementary and didactic expressions. We learn about music, dance, and song, how to celebrate ourselves, about aesthetics, and about humor and wit. And so that's in the traditional African education. So where is this curriculum in our African communities today? That's a question. I'm gonna ask a lot of questions, and we can talk about some of the answers later. Is it transmitted deliberately? There's a lot that we have and we retain as a culture in America and other places that we happen to retain because we're just living, but have we retained it? Has it been transmitted deliberately? And then does everyone acknowledge its value? I mean, I count it a blessing, this Richmond, Virginia thing, that I was raised in Southern Black communities where in my great-grandmother's generation, two sisters married two brothers, and so cousins have the same blood as brothers and sisters. And we're all living in the same streets that they've lived in for almost 100 years, and you know everyone's related. And so we're getting this cultural infusion, and then I go through graduate school and get the Temple and understand aesthetics and Africanisms and everything else, and I realize how blessed I was to be in a community where that was transmitted, even though it wasn't African cultures being transmitted deliberately. It was part of our practice. And so these are some of the broader thoughts for application that I've prepared today. Okay, so my purpose, getting to the nitty gritty, my purpose this evening is to describe and to innovatively theorize exactly what takes place in an Africana Studies literary classroom. Okay, so I'm one of the handful of literary scholars trained in the Afrocentric paradigm who teaches the discipline in my literature courses. And so that's growing and it's evolving, and I'm very grateful for the handful of people who are participating in that, but it's more a structural thing rather than an interest thing. And so when I say describe and innovatively theorize what takes place in our classrooms, I'm speaking of advancing the discipline using the Afrocentric paradigm in my English class, in my Africana literature course, not English. I'm speaking of institutionalizing the subject area of literature from a disciplinary point of view. When we've talked about institutionalizing Africana studies, that means that we have a bona fide space that no one can take away that's part of our social system, our social institutions. So Temple, you can go get several degrees in Africana. And so I'm saying, what about institutionalizing those subject areas? What are the subject areas of Africana studies? It depends on who you ask. In my class, I teach that there's 17. I take it all the way to geography and linguistics and Pan-Africanism, and health science and technology are categories that I add to what Karinga offers, to what Asante offers. Asante offers culture and aesthetics and communication in his list. Karinga offers creative production and politics and other categories. And finally, to understand what takes place in Africana Studies literary classroom, it's clarifying the practical enterprise. We know in Africana Studies we have the academic enterprise and we have the practical enterprise. And in my literature classrooms, we don't just sit in the ivory tower. We figure out and have exercises and assignments that help us to get out of to get that knowledge out of the classroom. And so back to the Ogunleye definition, he says folklore represents a line to a vast interconnected network of meaning, values, and cognitions. The morsel, one, I keep saying that, but one of the significant morsels that I want to leave with us today is to place the word cognition or cognitive, the cognitive approach to our interpretation of what should be done with Black literatures in Africana studies and in the community in general. And so I want to fashion a better understanding of Africana cognitive reading. Africana cognitive reading. Now, this word cognitive, it appears in a lot of, it appears in linguistics and sociology and psychology, but we really need to understand what that is. And I've been looking it up, and I haven't been seeing, I've been researching it, and I haven't been seeing it applied to what goes on in a literature classroom. And that's part of the uniqueness of the of Africana studies. So cognition is a group of mental processes that include attention, memory, producing and understanding language, learning, reasoning, problem solving, and decision making. And so it sounds very similar to location theory and other aspects of Afrocentricity, but I want us to take a minute to claim Africana, that word cognitive, and apply it to what we do in Africana studies classrooms. And so as I explore this, I want to talk about eight things really quickly this evening. Number one, I want us to understand what disciplinary competency is in the literary enterprise. Disciplinary competency. The next is applied functionality, or just function. I'm trying not to make it sound so academic, but that's what I call it, applied functionality. The next is generational shifts. What exactly has happened to get us where we are today that I'm one of a handful of people doing what I do with literature, and more of us should be doing it. The next is understanding how the literary enterprise has been categorized in Africana studies. And then all this culminates into our future objective, which is literary transcendence. And I'm going to drive that point home by sharing some of the thematic concerns, literary anecdotes, and the performance of storytelling, as well as, per the title, one of my innovative approaches to Africana, to Black folklore, literature, creative production, which is Black cultural mythology. And so I'll come back to that. I'll come back to that in a minute. So let me, let's do some sacrilege to the system right now. So what if I told you I teach literature, I've been doing it for 16 years, and I don't like to read? Is it a crime to say that I'm ambivalent about reading? I mean, I'm not one to say I love to read, but I'm a thinker. I want the knowledge that's in the books. I want to know and ponder deep philosophical and culturally relevant ideas. But what if I was not necessarily a lover of books and readings? And I'm speaking about the longer texts, the novels, the Dickens structured out of that tradition, the 250-page text. And so I read text. I do it for a living. I'm good at it. I remember what I read. And I mark up the margins with debates and categorizations of what I see in the text. But let's take a moment and pretend that we don't really like to read all of these pages, and that literature, that there's something artificial about sitting by yourself with a 300-page book all that time turning the page to get whatever you're getting from that. And in that sense, let's view reading longer works as a let's consider the novel as a surrogate form that gives us kind of what we need, but it's written and it's a surrogate. We've inherited it, we embrace it, but we must acknowledge its distance as a literary form from what we had before. And so on that list I gave you of what we received from African traditional education, in one sense, our Black novels are recapturing that. And it's a good thing, but our critical process of understanding who we are culturally is to understand the difference from what we had orally and how we're getting that from a novel form. So another anecdote, when I've lived my life in cities where I haven't had kin. I've been moving up with degrees and new jobs and stuff like that. And I used to go to the movies. I used to watch two movies back to back because I had time on my hands. And then when I find myself in Virginia with family, even for weeks and months at a time, I completely lost interest in going to the movie theater because what was happening around my kin, sitting around the family with a great aunt and a grandmother and my father and other people, was it satisfied the need I had to take in something that was intriguing. And so it was in the homestead, it was informative, representative of comfort and familiar African ethos, culturally entertaining with humor, wit, cleverness, mimicry, dance, music, song. It was intergenerational, infused with aspects of cultural memory, and gave me experiences where each time I left it, kind of driving back 4 hours or so, where I think 4 hours or so to where I was going, thinking about, wow, you know, that story they told about granddaddy cutting out cardboard, putting it in the bottom of his shoes, and what it meant to so-and-so, and my dad trying to clean his green jeans, one pair of pants for Christmas. He used Ajax on them and got, because they were out of soap powder, and they turned white, spotty, and faded, but that's the pants they had, being poor, and what he had to wear for the next couple of months, or whatever, 6 months, rest of the school year. But leaving with the morsel of understanding values and content and deeper aspects of the Black experience. And so Africana literature includes that, and it reflects who we are culturally. So let me ask a question. Would you rather sit in your house and read a 300-page novel, or would you rather go to a Sinbad, Richard Pryor, or Bill Cosby concert show? Book? Comedy show? Okay. Just think again about how we get what we get in shorter offerings and in face-to-face interaction, and how we're able to transmit culture by speaking and orality. And so a key concept of approaching literature from an Africana studies perspective is that we view the cycle as a tradition of orality and cultural behavior and memory written in a text, but that the objective is to then for us to recycle storytelling by talking about what we read and capturing the morsels of story that make up these texts. Okay, so I want to move on to my understanding disciplinary competency, applied functionality, generational shifts, and so on, so that I can share what goes on, what the conditions are for teaching literature, that's just me, I'm teaching literature in Africana studies classroom. Disciplinary competency. This means that the Africana literature course a person takes through the English department in this contemporary age is different compared to the Africana literature course one will take in the Africana studies department. Disciplinary competency is verification that pedagogically speaking, how we teach, the instructor's theoretical and paradigmatic understandings of the discipline is established and sound and informs her objectives, his or her objectives for the literary enterprise. I've had meetings at Pitt with the English department with faculty teaching the same thing I do who want to cross-list and other things, and we don't do the same things in our class. And even that tiny fine-tuning that we don't do the same things in our class is misunderstood, and the expectation is, so I do what's done in the literature classroom. I'm looking at periodization, literary conventions, forms, the writerly process, all of that, but I find time to do that extra applied part. We may go to statistics and understand exactly what's being presented in the class. And that what I find extra time to do is applied functionality. Applied functionality is, its charge to readers is to not only critique and historicize the text, but to find ways to understand the context, the conflicts illuminated by the text within a social science problem-solving mode. And some people call that the sociology of literature. We do it for Black people. And then to find ways to use the literature as a cultural tool beyond the walls of the academy. And I had a course where we read James Baldwin's collected essays. It was actually Introduction to Africana Studies. But in the end, my students had to create an 8x10 format with 12 to 13 quotes, and you know that's easy for Baldwin, that they illuminate in a form that's digitally pleasing, and what they produced kind of looked like mini placemats that I would buy from a vendor at an Africana Studies conference. And I have it on my desk now, and it's inspiring to me, and we're planning on getting those out into the community to give to some of the school-age classrooms. And so, considering disciplinary competency and applied functionality, it makes me think of a critique I read of Susan Laurie Parks's play, In the Blood. I taught that this semester. Did anyone see In the Blood? It's where Susan Laurie Parks draws on The Scarlet Letter, Nathaniel Hawthorne's novel, The Scarlet Letter, and she shifts it around, and she makes the main character Hester La Negrita, and so she gives a black woman a Spanish last name, which suggests that she could be black, Puerto Rican, Afro-Venezuelan, Afro-Colombian, but she's in the United States. She has five children by five different fathers, and they are homeless and they live under a bridge. And so she draws on classical Greek techniques, such as having a chorus, but the chorus functions differently. They're all, instead of representing what the community thinks kind of as an expected collective, they're pointing fingers. She also has these confessions of each character that's manipulating Hester. And she also has, it seems like she has used elements of Euripides' Medea, as well as the Oedipus tragedy, to infuse her narrative. And so the writer wrote about, and he's entitled to this, he wrote about the classical Greek elements as a priority of what he sees when he reads, or when he reads Susan Laurie Parks' play. As an Africana studies person, I think Parks wrote the play using those things as signifiers because she manipulated them for a African-American audience and African-American use, but she her lasting contribution is challenging the audience to self-examine their race, class, and sexuality prejudices because her play proves to the audience that they too were sitting there and judging a homeless, unemployed, frustrated Afro-Latina mother who has five children out of wedlock. And so it's a slightly different thing, but we want to, we review all of this information in our classes, but we end up on a slightly different note. The next is generational shift, and it's nice to have Charles Fuller here because he probably knows of what I'm speaking, but as I go to my black literary conferences, I notice that there is a shift in the well-roundedness of the black literary scholar. So back in the era of Sonia Sanchez and Trudier Harris and Joanne Gabin and Sandra Govan, these black scholars, literary critics and scholars are still active, but when they present, they're doing what we now call Africana studies, because they're the people on whose shoulders scholars like I am standing on, but the several generations between are shocked to find that people are doing innovative literary studies from an Africana studies department. And so I'm looking for peers in these places, and I'm having to re-educate my peers about what we do in our departments, and it's like, how could you forget us when even the black arts and black aesthetic traditions, they reinforced all of that. And so that's part of the English department shift. And even as recently as a couple of years ago, in the Chronicle, one of the leading scholars in African American literature wrote about, I'm not going to give his name, he wrote about, because he's a friend of mine, a restatement of, there's a so-called literary assumptions of black studies that's being scapegoated in English departments among black scholars, saying that we're not rigorous. And we've heard these before. But this they're still promoting it in 2011 and 2012. I can't even believe it. And so that's some of the competition that we're up against. And it's kind of like in the early Pan-Africanist movement, the scholars like Nkrumah and Azikiwe, who cut their teeth on Pan-Africanism, interacting with within a diaspora mode. The ones who came after them, viewing Pan-Africanism as just a continental phenomenon, they kind of missed what was going on. And that's what's happening in black literary studies. Okay, have any of you read Iola Leroy? Iola Leroy is the first African-American novel. And I did a content analysis of the articles published on Iola Leroy compared to what we discovered in my class happens in the novel, and it's not, what we discover in the Africana studies class is not documented in the research on that text so far. And so part of the predicament of being a younger area of study where we have the opportunity to teach Africana studies literature from an Africana studies department with an Africana studies paradigm is that we're catching up, and so there's a need for us to publish and to create our own journals to make sure that we capture and we demonstrate exactly what the trends are and what the trends should be as we advance the literary enterprise. And so let me just say real quickly that my treatment of English departments And we were trying to guess who you are. You all are. Some of you look like teachers. It's not. It is not a dismissal of what's done in English departments. It's an acknowledgement of the innovation that's permitted to take place in Africana Studies Department for the sake of helping African people understand who are we culturally, using the long view of what literature is, and it's not just written, and its objectives are not to be reproduced only in writing. Now, part of our challenge is to understand the categorization of literature in Africana studies. Asante describes a literary activity somewhere under culture and aesthetics, and possibly communication as well. Karinga speaks of the literary enterprise under creative production. And Greg Carr, for his conceptual chart for Philadelphia school system, categorizes literature under movement and memory and cultural meaning making. And so that's about five or six different ways that we say I do literature in Africana studies. And I wonder, I think that there's a need for us to institutionalize literature within the department as one of the subject areas. And we can call it what we want, because I like memory and aesthetics. It's all infused. And even that is a description that reiterates how what we do in our classes with literature, with that tradition, is different. Okay, so when we think of back to cognition, if we're going to advance an Afrocentric reader theory, Afrocentric cognitive reading theory, usually call and response is going to be the first thing that comes to our mind. When I'm in literary environments and we shift and we talk about audience, it's about ritual, it's about call and response and how those are African elements that advance the work that our writers have done in a different sort of way. But I also want us to consider what distinguishes our reading and engagement of a text. What is it that we want? And I have a list here, and it's about having a different objective, a thought process, a different intuitive purpose, and a different anticipation of how the literature should function. We want to be entertained, but we also want other things. And so what exactly are those other things that we want of our literatures? Number one, we want cleverness. Do you understand the difference between humor, being funny, humor and clever, or humor and wit and clever? Clever is a more intellectually, it's about your cognitive thought process. It says that more is involved than just telling a slapstick, happy, entertaining joke, but there's a cultural thought process involved that is ingenious, that's strategic, and that's culturally grounded. We want to be entertained, but our versions of what entertainment means is about what's intellectually and culturally satisfying based on intrigue, humor, and effect. We want African cultural values to be motives for characterization and plot, even though we are mature enough to process a story that's about villains or cultural undesirables. We want to see Africa as a source, and however briefly mentioned, as a source of the continuum of the literature. We want to see evidence of the processes of using our culture as tools for survival and as intellectual tools. We want to see our linguistic codes and code switching maximized in the communication. We want to see intergenerational communication. That's one of the my pet peeves as I view literature and even viewing scripts and films and reading stories, to see Black characters who go through crises, but they never call their mama. And they never talk to their sister. And these characters exist in isolation. So even that's a demarcation. And it's not that they're isolated like I am in Pittsburgh. I still talk to my parents every day. We expect to find some commentary, whether it's favorable or of rejection, depending on the point the author is making, of spirituality, of the supernatural, or life forces beyond our own mortality. And we don't want to be offended by the careless use of cultural non-negotiables. We know what those are, right? The N-word and other things, cultural non-negotiables. And then we don't want to be insulted by shallow uses of stereotypes or acultural stock characters. And so as African readers, we carry criteria in our consciousness as an additional lens we use to interpret the soul of a text. This critical process is what gives us a vision of the possibilities of applied functionality, which is how we can increase the life chances and life experiences of people of African descent in particular, and of humanity in general, by transmitting or sharing some aspect of the literary creative production in our practical enterprise. So when this process is done, we have literary transcendence, and it includes everything I've spoken of. Literary transcendence is the goal, the desired outcome of Afrocentric reader theory when we think about cognition, when we think about the memory and the attention and all of those elements I listed as part of cognition, producing and understanding language, of knowing, perceiving, remembering, learning, reasoning, problem solving, and decision making. So you all look bored. I'm just playing. This is okay. This is the academic talk. We're finished with that. And so if you have questions about that and these key concepts, now we're going to apply those in the literature in these celebratory morsels of things I've read and studied that I think, and I'm going to talk about how I think they're genius and profound. So with respect to the thematic concerns and literary anecdotes, there are several literary situations and in-text phenomena found in literature of Africa and the diaspora from my recent reading that really stand out and introduce opportunities for powerful Afrocentric anecdotes relevant to the topic of folklore and who are we culturally and the innovative uses of literature. First one, there's a novel called Salvage the Bones by Jessamine Ward. Has anyone read Salvage the Bones? What? She won the 2011 National Book Award, and she's a sister from Mississippi. She experienced Hurricane Katrina. She's been in writing. She has an MFA. But she writes this narrative about a black motherless family, the mother passed, in a place called Bois Sauvage, Mississippi. And she deals with their poverty, their love, the balance that they maintain. And it's one girl, it's one sister, three brothers, and a father. The mother passed from illness, giving birth to the youngest child. But one of the main points of contention in the text is, in spite of how struggling they are, their family is intact. And in spite of how struggling they are, the middle brother owns a white pit bull named China. And they describe this dog as the loveliest of white. I mean, the description is beautiful. I didn't quote from, but the description is beautiful, but she's created this whole narrative of how my one troublesome brother loves that dog so much that he is he doesn't pay attention. He even takes the food that they're putting together to make it through Hurricane Katrina and gives some of it to the pit bull. And this is, this is modern stuff. And then when their community floods and he's trying to save the dog and his sister needs saving, he lets the dog go. And he saves his sister. And the dog drowns and is never found again. And it's a new novel, 2011. There's not a lot on it, but when I write about it, I'm going to write about the symbolism when you read the text. The man is so, the young boy is so devoted to the dog that to sacrifice whiteness, what exactly is this whiteness? She never relates the dog to white people. She doesn't say he loved white girls. White girls aren't even in the book. They're too poor to be partaking of white culture, which is capitalist and consumer in the first place. Their community is immersed. It's a black, just layered self-help community. White people aren't there except on the periphery. They stole apples or something. But she doesn't talk about heavy-handedly with white people being in the worldview, but the sacrifice of this dog is even gut-wrenching for readers who didn't appreciate the dog. I mean, I can appreciate a dog and boy story, but the symbolism of the white dog is profound because there's no context for whiteness in their family, culture, and kinship are so strong, and the silence on whiteness. Think to live your life and to have a silence on whiteness where you, and all of its negatives, that's equated with a dog that you sacrifice thoughtlessly, in spite of how much you love that dog, you realize that family is more important than animals. And I see something there. And in my class, we take that to the head. We really the silence on whiteness, read as privilege and false universals. She didn't even talk about them, but she talks about their poverty, even though their bond is a death blow. And it just makes me say, post-racial what? Because it's just that profound. And so it's negative post-racial because she doesn't give whiteness a footing as at all as a determiner of black life, even though they're poor. The next novel is, the next excerpt is from Edwidge Danticus, The Dewbreaker. And so these are, I'm pulling up morsels from teaching that create profound moments for our contemporary, for our modern readership, for my classes, for our community. And sometimes we don't have to read the whole thing in order to understand its value. We can get to that, but I'm celebrating this. Edwidge Danticat wrote a novel called The Dewbreaker in 2005. Has anyone read that? It's about a sadistic and violent Haitian prison guard who immigrates to Brooklyn to reinvent himself as a non-threatening member of the diaspora. But Brooklyn proves to be a small world, just as small as the communities of Haiti, because he's recognized and feared abroad in the United States, just as he was, or creating an uncomfortable amount of anxiety, just as he was as a leader of the Tonton Macoute. What does this do to the African-American assumption of Pan-Africanism? And how does it relate to our geopolitical challenge of being acutely informed of the foreign policy and international current events to the extent that we're capable of properly taking sides when we view a phenomenon? And so this man is a barber in Brooklyn, and this is his narrative. The way he acted at the Inquisitions in his own private cell at the Caserne eventually earned him a lofty reputation among his peers. He was the one who came up with the most physically and psychologically taxing trials for the prisoners on his block. He was suffering, he knew it now, from what one of his most famous victims, the novelist Jacques Alexis, had written with the greatest hazard of job: tu deviens un véritable gendarme, un bourreau. You become, you definitely become a police officer now, an executioner, a tormentor, a hangman. It was becoming like any other job. He liked questioning the prisoners, teaching them to play Zoe and Bezique, stapling clothespins to their ears as they lost and removing them as he let them win, convincing them that their false victories would save their lives. He liked to paddle them with braided cowhide, stand on their cracking backs and jump up and down like a drunk on a trampoline, pound a rock on the protruding bone behind their earlobes until they couldn't hear the orders he was shouting at them, tie blocks of concrete to the end of sisal ropes and balance them off their testicles if they were men or their breasts if they were women. And she goes on describing the atrocities. And guess what? This is the man who's cutting your hair when you're going to the Brother Barbershop in Brooklyn. I want to spend my class talking about that. I want to spend my time talking about how many of us have been to Haiti. How many of us understand that Haiti's history, its cultural history, its legacy as being the first diaspora-wide mythology with the successful revolution. How many of us understand Haitian immigration and what transpires with that on the coast of Florida? And how many of you would be comfortable knowing that a brother like this is cutting your hair? Does it matter? What does that do to your Pan-Africanism? And so there are a lot of things that we take time to illuminate in our text, in our classes, that that you won't get time dedicated to that. It's a miracle we do everything, writing and analysis, but it's fascinating. So the next is from Patina Gappa, is a writer from Zimbabwe. P-T, one T, two P's. Patina Gappa, G-A-P-P-A-H. She wrote a collection of stories in 2009 called An Elegy for Easterly. And there's a short story called Something Nice from London. And she has quite a vision of what's going on with respect to culture and how diaspora-wide we ask the question through the literature, and I like to read, okay, that was a devil's advocate. Through the literature, we're learning to ask different sorts of questions. And so in this story, Something Nice from London, mangled by a youth generation disgusted with Zimbabwe's post-independence and neocolonial politics and debt that make traveling to England the most attractive, though most expensive situation, a daughter proves the damage done to her African sensibility by being so corrupted by European capitalism and cultural disrespect that age-old burial customs are incomprehensible to her. And she is sacrilegious, careless in her modern personhood. Burial customs, aren't they sacred? So here's what happens. When a wayward, alcohol, drug-addicted African son dies abroad, the family sends telegrams and letters over distance, trying to get his body for a proper burial in the land of his ancestors. And so the text read, they cannot mourn him without seeing his body. He came from the dust, and to the dust he must return to be interred whole, intact. A great uncle says, is it not bad enough that Peter died over the oceans where the baleful influence of alien spirits could not be discounted? Never before, he said, has a son of Chiquiro been buried away from the lands of his ancestors. The family goes to the airport one time, and you're thinking you've got mourners coming all from distant places to mourn. So you've got several dozen people in the house. They're feeding them. They're expecting a body. They go to the airport. They wait for hours. The body doesn't show up. They leave dejected, and they go back about a week later to claim the body from the airport. And so a woman walks up to the sister of the deceased, and she says, at the airport after they've waited, she says, I have something from your cousin Lisa. She said it was a special delivery and didn't want to have to go through customs. People sing me with things, you know, nice things from London. I charge only £50 per package. Here is the package. Enjoy. I take the box and walk toward Jonathan. We both look at the package wrapped in gaudy purple and silver paper and tied with a purple ribbon. I open the box to reveal an urn of dark wood. Peter's name is engraved on a brass plate on the lid. Taking the cheap way out. Do you understand what happens here? The traditional Zimbabwean family is full of anxiety, communing at that kind of sacred time of the passing, with communing with the ancestors, waiting to bury the body, relying on someone who's gone to England to still be culturally Zimbabwean and understands. And she puts them off, has them running around to the airport to claim a body in a coffin, right? And they get there, it's not there, and then a woman delivers an urn of his ashes to the family. I mean, even that gives me chills to just take pause, just take a moment to think about what that means. And so Patina Gappa captures that in a short story. We know the short story structure is, it's very concise. No line is empty or shallow or fluff. It's very concise. It's short enough to be read in one sitting. And this is what she gives us, the travesty that our African minds are not where they're supposed to be, even in this example in the continent, that a daughter of the village, of the community, would cremate a body and deny a proper African burial. And so we want to deal with that in our text as well. Another part that happens in African literature, and this relates to the oral traditions and the written traditions, happens in Sindiwe Magona's novel Mother to Mother from 1998. And this is a South African novel written around the fact of the white graduate student who thought she could go into the black communities, the townships, thank you, into the townships against all common sense advice, and she gets killed. She gets killed by a mob. And so it's a complex work, but what happens is, I'll let you hear. A granddaughter says, you have mail. The grandmother says, where's it from? She says, East London. East London? She stopped the sewing and looked up. "East London," she repeated. However, this time her words were more exclamation than question. "Yes, Makulu," I said, "it is from East London." "Hurry and get everything inside," she said quietly. "It's not rain, but a deluge that'll fall upon us if that letter's from Funiway." In the same unhurried voice, she continued, sewing still in her hand. She had not resumed the mending, but sat there, looking at me as though she couldn't quite believe what I said. "Auntie Funiway is Mama's younger sister, her only sister. What are you waiting for?" Makulu asked suddenly. "Open it and read it for me." "What?" Midway through the letter, she interrupted my meeting. "Read me that again," she said. "Read over that again." I did. Again and again, Makulu made me stop and go over some detail. The mending carelessly thrust to her side. For once, she had not folded it neatly and put it back into the sewing bag. She sat still, her jaw dropped so her mouth hung open as her eyes stared blindly into the distance. "Hey, child of my child," Makulu said solemnly. Her voice a bare whisper, she continued without looking at me, standing there at her feet. "Where does it say this letter that is coming from Funiway? This letter that it is coming from Funiway," she asked, eyes still focused on some distant object only she could see. I showed her the name, knowing full well the squiggles on the page meant nothing to her. She scrunched her face, eyes narrowed to a slit. She peered at the point where my finger lay. It would not have mattered two hoots whether I'd showed her to the salutation body or ending of the letter, but the way she pored over those letters made me a little uneasy, as though she could really divine the mystery they held. And so through this process, the grandmother asked her to reread the letter 8 times. She asked her to repeat other sections in addition to these 8 times, and then she asks her again if the letter is actually from her daughter. And I've described this as lost in translation. Think of the grandmother's generation does not value the epistolary, which is what we call the writing form, which appears a lot in literature, and it often appears in literature as a way of one character being a coward to either attack another character or to offer some sort of misinformation. And this just has us beg the question, what does migration and immigration, from Africa to Europe and to the Americas, what exactly does that do to our sense of the truth about the predicament our kin is in? I think of also Edwards Danticat has a story, again from her Haitian collection in The Dewbreaker, where she, a woman, writes letters back and forth home to her mother, and she's lying that everything's okay, but she's about to have an abortion and take a life and some other things. So there's a lot put on the table here. Now, I'd like to move for a moment to African American. How am I doing for time? Okay, that's good. You all are going to remember what I just read. I want you to experience it like it's the first time. He kicked the screen out of the window and held the kids off of the sill. "You gonna marry me?" "Yeah, I'll marry you anything, but bring the children back in the house." He looked from where the kids were hanging from the 5th story at all the people screaming at him, and he started sweating again, said to all the neighbors, "You gonna marry me?" I stood by Bo in the window with Naomi reaching for me and Kwame screaming, "Mommy, Mommy," from the 5th story, but I could only whisper, and he dropped them. What is that from?
For Color Girls.
For Color Girls. I saw For Color Girl, and is anybody's skin crawling? I mean, if we can take a time to think about if a man really with PTSD drops his children out the window, mixed up mental health challenges, all of those things, but to drop children out the window. I saw the play, and I was just one of those things. Someone said, "Come go with me." I was young, and I went. So years later, I was like, when was that movie? What was that gut-wrenching movie I saw where this man dropped somebody's kids out the window? And it was so powerful in my first exposure to it that I had a reel in my mind, that I saw this happening and just experienced all the emotional effect with which Ntozake Shange wrote about it. And let's see, I'm going to skip to. And all of us have seen Raisin in the Sun, right? Of course. We're all familiar with Raisin in the Sun. Raisin in the Sun doesn't give us the chill of tragedy and loss like that, but we can relate, right? We relate to a mother trying to do what's best for her children. We relate, sadly, to, I'm going to say this based on my last viewing of Raisin in the Sun on Broadway, the narcissism of a grown son in addition to what he's going with. When I saw the performance of Raisin on Broadway with P. Diddy, it wasn't P. Diddy that day, but it was a really powerful actor, but he presented the character as so emotionally abusive to his mother, wife, and sister that I was like, wow, this is timeless. And the expectation, we know what he's going through as a brother, but also the expectation that the family would contribute to his dream and Bobo and Willie and, you know, the money disappears, but both powerful sources, of course. So George Wolfe, what does he do? He comes with the Colored Museum, with the Last Mama on the Couch play, which is satire of the womanist themes in Ntozake Shange for colored girls. It's looking at how Raisin was performed with the level of oversaturation in the nation at the expense of other playwrights just as brilliant and moving right on. And he names his main character, well, he names his character, his male character, Walter Lee Bo Willie Jones. Walter Lee, of course, from Raisin, and Bo Willie from Dropping the Children Out the Window. And you remember the scene in Raisin where, I don't know, Ruth is saying, Walter, eat your eggs. Walter, eat your eggs. You know, man trying to tell you his dreams, and all you can say is, Walter, eat your eggs. And so is anyone, well, I know someone's familiar with this, but so enter Walter Lee Bo Willie Jones, his mama's 30-year-old son, his brow is heavy from 300 years of oppression. Son, did you wipe your feet? And every erupting volcano, no, Mama, I did not wipe my feet. Out to every day, Mama is a man, Mama, Mr. Charlie, Mr. Bossman, and he's wiping his feet on me, Mama, every darn day of my life. Ain't that enough for me to deal with? Ain't that enough? Son, wipe your feet. I want to dream. I want to be somebody. I want to take charge of my life. You can do all that, but first you got to wipe your feet. And so it goes on and on. And then Walter Lee Bo Willie's wife entered. Remember? She enters. And after she does her twirling and dancing, he says, now you going to cook me dinner? You're going to cook me dinner? And because he's standing there agitated, cook me dinner while she's doing her poetics. And so he goes and gets two black doll babies out the room and throws them out the window and she lets out a primal scream, and she says, he dropped them. And then the narrator breaks out into applause. Wonderful, wonderful job. So how do you go from the skin-crawling nature of Ntozake Shange's play, that episode, that vignette, that we're thinking about all the men with coming back from Vietnam who might have some mental challenges, we're thinking of the relationships and women investing that, and the black life loss, whether Bo Willie dropped them out of the window or not, but black life loss, but something as atrocious and tragic as that. And then when it reappears here, it's supposed to be comedy. It's supposed to be comedy, and then it's also signifying on our voyeurism and spectatorship, but now we're laughing about it, and then it gets to a point where there's a lot of complaining, and there's this Juilliard singing in the background of spirituals, and it turns into this, why? That's a question. I'm just kidding. I do have a sense of, sometimes culture gets heavy. Sometimes culture, the negative aspects of our existence gets heavy. And we want to have a release from that and turn it into a color purple Thanksgiving dinner moment. Does anybody else replay that scene or know it by heart? The table scene. Oh, okay. This is a, okay, y'all make me feel real secular right about now. No, it's a scene in a movie, and I forget how true that, I mean, it's imagined, but where after all Celie has gone through, that emotional release and humor is the only, well, they use that as a tool, as she takes the knife and holds it to the man's neck and says, "Till you do right by me, everything you do is going to fail." And then Oprah's character starts laughing because that was some breakthrough for her. There's an interesting thing that we do with culture. And if we want to understand humor, wit, being clever, and the difference, and also the release from some of the pain sometimes, this becomes this interesting triangle to understand how we get from those two to here. And that's some of the things we take time in our classes to do. So I have one more example. Back to the Haiti piece. My current, the topic of this talk looks also at innovation in literature. And in this modern era, having a PhD from Temple in Africana Studies, the first department to offer a doctoral program, being privileged to have this information, part of our task is to create relevant cultural theory that helps us better understand our experience. And I have inherited the topic of Black cultural mythology, which I hope to get out very, you know, in the next couple of years. But Black cultural mythology as an organic view of African American life, and it can also be applied to the diaspora. But it draws on the criteria for Black art cultural mythology that Larry Neal, Coringa, Black arts folks put forth, but did not develop it, advance it theoretically based on some of the tools we have and the paradigms we have now. It also draws on this Black psychologist Amos Wilson's discussions of the need for cultural mythology in his book on the developmental psychology of the Black child. And it's based on a good set of foundations and exemplars from the culture. But Black cultural mythology is a new orientation to interpreting our cultural traditions. Beginning again in 1619, which is something Dr. Sante offers in his book Afrocentricity, and engraving identity on new soil since 1619, Black cultural mythology holds that this was a process of intuitive epic conduct. Do you realize these words? Intuitive epic conduct that produced a spirit of hyper-heroic behavior that forms the core of our survival and our strivings. Intuitive epic conduct and hyper-heroic behavior. So physiologically speaking, if I wanted to commit suicide and I tied a bag around my head and some duct tape, right? Lots of duct tape, can't tell where it ends. When I start to expire, what does the body's will to survive has me doing what? Grasping, trying to get it off. And so during enslavement, when we were kidnapped and brought to these shores, our experience was like having a bag over our head, and intuitive with respect to that same sort of physiology that has us grasping, we engaged in intuitive epic conduct that produced hyper-heroic behavior. And so Harriet Tubman is no accident. That's cultural, and all of our Gabriel Prosser and our other heroes. And so the second part of Black cultural mythology is that Black writers and artists, because you can't forget Jacob Lawrence, what he did with several Haitian Revolution and American Underground Railroad. Black writers are a visionary group that most consistently recycles this cultural material to help us engage the features of this list of features of Black cultural mythology: hero dynamics, ancestor acknowledgement, immortalization, cultural memory, heritage practices, legacy tools, and the anti-hero, because we also have to understand that. And so those are the components of Black cultural mythology. And so in advancing this in the text, I want to share an example with you. I have a couple, depending on time, but is anyone familiar with the poet Laini Mataka? Probably never heard of her. She's a Washington, D.C. poet, and she must have 10 or 12 books by now. But I learned of her because Acklin Lynch would always have her performing at his house for his, you know, his, I guess I just call them salons, his meetings and gatherings of black people, Laini Mataka. She's undersung, she's not anthologized, she has a lot of work, but as an Afrocentric literary scholar, I don't have to be concerned with the canon. I'm putting her in my classroom because she's part of the Afrocentric canon, and that's a whole nother topic. And so, Laini Mataka dedicates this poem called Freedom's Diva Should Always Be Loved to Harriet Tubman and Dr. Welsing, Frances Cress Welsing. She said, and again, the variables, hero dynamics, ancestor acknowledgement, immortalization, cultural memory, heritage practices, legacy tools, the anti-hero. So heroes, freedom's diva should always be loved. She says, I like to think that somewhere between the bodacious flights and unbelievable weariness, a quilted cloud was laid out on the ground, and a big Sudanese-looking warlord dropped his weapons, and a fragile creature of living ebony fell into his arms laughing, as she imagined the look on old Master Tom's face when he realized his best 10 field hands were gone. Do you realize what she's done to Harriet Tubman? She's given her a man who's sitting there waiting to protect her because her husband didn't want to join her flight. And it's like, no, I'm gonna stay here. But in our imaginings of what we, how we praise and render honor to her memory, Laini Mataka is giving her a relationship of someone to be provider, supportive, stability. Okay, she says, I like to think that history just never got its name, but that when Harriet came in from off the road, there was food on the table, a fire in the hearth, and the general understanding that he would reverse her aches and turn them into derringers that she could stuff in her clothes for protection on her next trip. And so she even restates what male protection is supposed to be for the black community. He's giving her guns as he keeps the homestead down. Because freedom was and should always be the goal of every black person on the planet. I like to think that when Harriet was gearing up for her next rescue mission, that he argued to go with her, to help her, to hold her if a sleeping fit came, to protect her from possible capture or betrayal. I like to think that in the end, she always left with as much of him as she could depart with and still stay alive, that he gave his blessings and did spiritual somersaults to gain God's attention, to make sure Harriet's tenacious back. I like to think that he left every pore open to try and gauge, even from a distance, if Harriet was all right, that sleep rejected his advances as long as absence left her side of the bed empty and his nuller than void. And so in black cultural mythology, writers have the license to do benign, innocuous embellishment of the hero dynamic. She's still celebrating Harriet, and we don't know who Harriet loved or who was with her there to support her, but that speculative enterprise does not take away from the root that Harriet had a profound legendary status and mythological status in our community. And then I want to end on looking at the text There Is Confusion by Jesse Fawcett. And that seems to be an infrequently taught novel of 1924. But with respect to, if I did not have the lens of black culture mythology in this contemporary moment, we wouldn't be doing the right things with what the writer gave us. And so, very briefly, the first chapter of this 1924 early novel, women's novel of the Harlem Renaissance, talks about how this man's looking at his daughter. This man's looking at his daughter, and he says, you know, the family's gone, her three brothers and sisters, the mother. She says, Daddy, tell me a story. He's like, a story about what? A story about something great, Daddy. Great like I'm going to be when I get to be a big girl. He stared at her, amazed and adoring. She was a little living echo out of his own forgotten past. He was born a slave and the son of a slave in Richmond and had felt as a little boy the same impulse to greatness. And so she introduced this sense of greatness, and they call on Napoleon, Lincoln, and Garrison, all white men, but then they talk about Frederick Douglass and Toussaint Louverture and how the little girl wants to be like Harriet Tubman and Sojourner Truth. And that's where the novel starts. But what happens in the end, as we advance the novel, this desire to be great this desire to be great, which started in the culture's heroics, atrophies and degenerates to pride, ambition, a desire to break into art, into the glittering stage, into fame, and able to be a woman living without a man. But that sense of fame is where she kind of stops, where this greatness turned into a sense of fame. And even that's anti-heroic in our culture. But just that morsel of the beginning kind of gets lost. But in Africana studies, when we think of our cognition, our African Afrocentric cognitive readership, we look for and see different things in the literature. And I just thank you for listening to my presentation today as I tried to balance the academic, the theoretical, and some of the practical elements of what we do in the Africana Studies classroom. Thank you very, very much.
Okay, I told you guys, right? Okay, so it's wonderful. And we want to thank you. This was really, it was a great classroom. I learned a lot sitting there. Thank you again. Thank you. Please give her another hand. Thank you very much. Now, we do have time, so we save time for questions and for discussion, if that's okay with
discussion.
So who would like to start? I would just like, just to make a couple of comments. Well, first, I would like to ask a question regarding the non-negotiables.
Yes.
And as you know, there's been a lot of discussion around the use of the N-word. And I just want to know, is that one of the, what you would consider to be the non-negotiables in terms of the writers, contemporary writers, or how do you relate to that?
Yes.
Because that's a big... It's a big current topic.
That's a small one. That's one of many. That's one we think about right off. There are two perspectives. We don't need the word. It's passé. It's degenerative in our culture, but we have a right to use it in private if we want, as we should cease using it. But the part that's white people and other people can't use it. And I've been in my courses, as I talk about privilege and how we treat other cultures and how we achieve a high cultural competency, if you have a high cultural competency or respect for humanity, you're not going to borrow a pejorative word from their culture, even if they say it themselves. And so us getting it out of our vocabulary is being countered by other people using it freely based on that section of us who use it. So that's one. But other things would be like texts that take too much license with elements of our experience that are sacred. Mm. And so the first time I read Charles Johnson's novel, The Middle Passage, I found it to be an interesting enough story, but I found it to be sacrilegious and frivolous with respect to elements of our culture that we hold sacred. And so there is, I tried to teach academic and cultural literature in my text because it makes my job easier if the literature is teachable and if it's written based on a writer who has experience as a creative writer. I.E. Kweyar Amah says you can't teach literature unless you're a writer. And so I've done some poetry and stuff, and I'm going to claim I'm a writer, but I'm a sincere cultural analyst. So if he knew what we learn through the Afrocentric paradigm, he'd give me a bye, even though I'm not a novelist or a playwright or something. But it's about not insulting the sacredness of our culture. And I see cultural non-negotiables in our interpersonal reactions, our interpersonal relations as well. And so I'm not teaching an activism class, but I tell my class, I had a college roommate who told me my junior year, I love biracial men. I love mixed men. I would love to have a mixed baby. I would love to have a mixed baby. And when I go to restaurants, I know that black men are so titillated by my attention, I bat my eyes a little more, and it's just, you know, I get such a kick out of seeing them. And I'm just like, how could you say that to me? But things like that, cultural things that we have to check, and I know it sounds crazy. It's crazy. I can see the expressions on your faces, but elements, lots of things such as that.
Okay, but if I just, one more I want to ask. So, because this comes up a lot. So the writer or the creator will say, okay, but you have established that category, non-negotiable.
Yes.
For me, that as the writer would say.
The writer said, I can write, but that doesn't resonate.
I can write what I want to write.
That's fine, because you give me something to teach about. And if we think of the literature as whatever you offer that's culturally relevant, it's not always going to be relevant because it's favorable.
Right.
It's relevant because I need to try to make sure that people in the future don't do what you've presented now, and so it becomes cliche, but a teachable moment. Okay. And so it's not confining anyone's art or expression. But as a literary critic, which is what we end up being as we publish, we comment on it.
Absolutely.
We comment on it, and we call it out, because our culture is so, the world wants to be so blameless and want to have a right to do whatever they want, that people act like there are not cultural non-negotiables. And so even proclaiming that to the writers and to others has us take a stand, I think, in the African-centered, Afrocentric way, that we're not going to tolerate that, and we're going to use the pen or criticism to counter some of it.